All right, so I live in Boulder, and that's just funny to begin with. And, you know, the thing about Boulder is it's very spiritual, but they have to talk about it being spiritual. And matter of fact, being spiritual, I think, is more important than being spiritual. To talk about this, Julie Rasmussen, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
All right, so here's the book, Hippy Dippy BS, because I can't say the other word because, you know, government and all.
Right.
All right, so here's my frustration, is that there are so many good things to talk about when it comes to your faith, when it comes to the big questions of life, when it comes to self-improvement and where you fit. But I don't want to talk to any of these people because they all drive me nuts. I don't want to talk to the guys from Naropa. I don't want to talk to the guys from the Buddhist thing. I don't want to talk to the people who apparently can only play bongos in City Park in order to reach their spiritual high.
Sure.
Who are these people?
who are these people?
Yeah, and who are you about this?
Well, I like to think I'm not. I'm one of those people we probably share common interests, but the point of my whole book, and the full title of the book, is I didn't believe any of this hippy-dippy BS, either a skeptic's awakening to the spiritual universe. So I was very much a skeptic of all of this stuff. I was honestly a very conservative Christian for many years. And then I kind of started pulling out of that. I started reading things like Eckhart Tolle and Deepak Chopra a little bit, and that cracked the door open. And then I started having some experiences a couple years ago that were coincidences that were too big to ignore, truthfully. And it made me start questioning, is there more going on? And so when I this was very Field of Dreams. I actually call this book an unplanned pregnancy. Not unwanted, but it was like an unplanned pregnancy, that there was a voice in my head that said, just write it down. Write down the skeptic's view. And so that's what I did. And my whole point was to never become this airy fairy, you know, too cosmic that it doesn't make any sense in this world kind of voice about it. Because
I've tried the Eckhart Tolle, Deepak Chopra stuff, and it just bounced off my forehead. It did not do anything.
Yeah.
But you said that you were a religious Christian. I'm sorry. I thought religious Christians were very spiritual. Isn't that the whole idea?
Well, I think in theory that's the whole idea. But now when I look back in hindsight, I could see. Really, I was very much addicted to the social atmosphere of it. I think I was honestly you get addicted to the church. You get addicted to that net that comes with it. There's many other aspects to it.
What do you mean, the social aspect or the net?
I think that besides it just being some personal connection that I had with this bigger source, what I was really enjoying about it, you know, being part of a church and being, you know, it was kind of like a mega church thing, was that I liked this huge community of people around me. I liked that we shared a common interest. I felt like I had a safe place to go to. And none of that's really bad. But I will say, I felt like now, from where I'm at now, that it really did distract me, actually, from having a very connected, you know, a good connection to a source.
Let me try this on for size. That idea of a church, there's two important things. One is a spirituality, as you said, connecting you to something much bigger.
Yeah.
The other part you also mentioned, which is this is a group of people who look out for each other.
Yeah.
We never had the government safety net. The government safety net doesn't work very well, but that safety net does work.
Mm-hmm.
That you want somebody around for those tough periods. You want to be around for other people when they're having tough times. You want to be around when they're having good times, and you want a sense that you belong.
Yeah.
And so if you're sitting at home meditating and you connect with a larger universe, that's great. But when you break your hip, it's nice when somebody brings you a casserole.
Right. Yeah,
and
I
church
agree.
Does that.
I agree. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that, but I think we do need to differentiate the two, is that I still think, you know, even for me, when I was in church and I was liking that social, it's almost a culture, truthfully, beyond. I think everything starts as a teaching, becomes kind of a tribe, starts to follow it, eventually becomes a religion, eventually becomes a culture that in many aspects gets very removed from what the original teaching was. And the fact that there's, you know, 30,000 different sects of Christianity alone tells you that man's kind of getting involved and sticking their thumb in what the original message was. So there is nothing wrong with having that cultural church, you know, that input. But I do think I have found a greater value in meditating by myself. I have found that connection is so much bigger than what we think. And it really opened the world to me that, you know, life is not this sourpuss thing to endure. Cross your fingers, hope you choose the right thing, and, you know, hope you choose the right religion, you get to go somewhere good later. It really changed. It was a huge shift that I went through. It was a big paradigm shift to come out of that into a conscious awareness that we really are. We are eternal beings.
Since you didn't believe that Hippy Dippy BS and either, that implies that now you do.
I do.
All right, so
some of it.
Let's try this from human to hippie.
Yeah.
Because it's tough.
I'm still human too.
No, hippies are not human. It's so if I, what's the difference between praying and meditating?
I would say the difference between praying and meditating, praying is usually asking for something. It's asking the source, give me this, help me with this. Meditating is really just calming that we have this incessant chatter that goes on in our mind. A lot of spiritual teachers call that your ego, that is full of negativity. It's full of old beliefs. And meditating is really just calming your mind to stop that chatter.
Scotch does the same thing.
I won't disagree with you one bit on that. It's funny the way, why do we medicate so much? Because it's actually doing, it's a facilitator to slowing that down as well. So I think there is a big reason why we do that.
You say that chatter, I'm thinking about those nights when you just can't sleep.
Yeah.
And it's like you're tuning from one station to the other really fast,
right.
And it's just and there's too many things. One of the beautiful things about being a guy is that we can compartmentalize, you know, to a stupid level.
Yeah.
You know, the house can be burning down. We go, wow, look what's on TV. You know,
yeah. Have a mess tomorrow.
Yeah, it doesn't. So, did your journey? God, I hate even talking
I know,
that
you
way.
You don't have to use that word.
So
my experience. Is that all right?
Yeah, I don't know.
It's better than journey.
Right. So what's the difference now? So if before you were in a church and you prayed, now you're meditating and you're finding out something else, what is that something else?
I think the biggest thing is that we're all equipped to, I think we're almost too dependent on other people. We're all much more intelligent and equipped to solve our own problems, to be our own network, to be our own net, truthfully. And it's very empowering when you start to realize that. When you do get in a state of meditation, you realize there is this universe, there is some kind of divine intelligence that exists that is behind us, that we can connect to, that does give guidance.
But didn't you believe that when you were a Christian?
You know, I think I believed it in a very different way than I do now. I thought if I did things right, I would get the help I needed. And I would say that's a big difference between, especially Christianity, there's judgment involved on whether things go wrong or right, and I would say in spirituality,
I don't think Christianity judgment. Has a corner on that market, by
yeah,
the way.
I agree with you. But as far as spirituality, that element of judgment, the universe, God, I call it God, the universe, Steve, call it whatever you want to call it, whatever that presence is, really isn't judgmental. It's just a neutral. And really, we are creating our own experiences. What we think is what we get. And I think I kind of eliminated the God throwing out the good card or the bad card with me, and I take more ownership for my own life.
All right. So this is where the Venn diagrams start to touch. In that, I think about guys like Napoleon Hill, who I think touched on some of those things.
Yeah.
You know, his big classic, Think and Grow Rich, you think, well, this is all about making money.
Yeah.
I guess, but no, that's not really what it was.
It wasn't, yeah.
It was about controlling your mind.
Yeah.
I think about Viktor Frankl, whose incredible book, Man's Search for Meaning, and trust me, I don't know how to read, but this one is worth reading. The guy who went through the concentration camps, and he realized that the difference between the people who survived and the people who couldn't make it was that no matter what life brings, the one thing you can control is how you react.
Yeah, exactly.
How you think.
Yeah.
And that in itself is just a remarkably empowering thought,
yeah.
At least in concept.
Yeah.
It's really hard in practice.
It is. And the reason it is hard in practice is kind of what I was saying before that many spiritual teachers are talking about is because we have that ego that is always this part of our personality that is based in fear that is trained to tell us negative messages. It's trained to teach us to be afraid. And as long as we keep listening to that, you do block yourself from the ability to have what you were just saying. So it is, I think, step one, really, of awakening or whatever you want to call it, is recognizing you have that negative voice. Everybody does. It's like we're, you know, sometimes the walking dead walking around this cloud of fear of negativity. And when you realize that is what you're doing, then you open the door to start going, okay, I can control more of what is happening. I can control my reactions and get to my true emotions instead of always having that do the speaking for me.
I think of it more in terms of evolution, that there's a reason we are so fearful.
Mm-hmm.
You know, fear has been really good to us. You know, fear.
It controls people.
Fear has kept me from jumping over cliffs. Yeah. And this is dangerous. I'm backing away. But we apply that fear to a whole bunch of stuff that
doesn't matter. I think originally the ego and fear was there to say, you know, look out, there's a saber-toothed tiger behind you. But now we're like, ooh, you only got 10 likes on Facebook on that. You know, it's like, oh, people don't really like you. You know, and so it is. It's going into this whole areas of our lives that really it never needed to be in. And it really is kind of overtaking us. And maybe we're at a place, you know, if this happened to me,
You keep saying this, and I hate pronouns because it's so. And this is where you're going to start like this is going to be Hippy Dippy BS, and I don't have patience for that.
Brace yourself.
All right. So what is this?
You're going to hate it. The word I'm going to use. It's awakening. People call it awakening. I call it a shift in consciousness. It was breaking that old paradigm.
You're not levitating when I'm not looking, are you? Not becoming just a beam of light
Stop
or something?
It. Stop it. Right. No, it was just it's a shift. It's a shift in my conscious understanding that I used to walk around that fear cloud as well. And my ego used to make all my decisions and control all my emotions. And once I had this experience and it awakened me to that, oh my God, I've been letting this fear control everything I'm doing, and started to recognize it, started to manage it, started to have such a more incredibly joyful, optimistic life, truthfully.
Well, and the part where I think we might find some common ground is that the idea of controlling the way you think and tackling the fear by looking right into the fear.
Right.
Saying, all right, let's play this out. Let's play out all the
Bring
fear.
It on. Here,
let's
Bring
let's
it on.
Spend some time and say, all right, let's see if this fear thing happens. I lose my job. I lose this. Mm-hmm. You know, I lose, you know, whoever. And then what happens?
Yeah.
And you realize
life goes on.
I can handle that.
But it's not everything. It isn't everything. A lot of people that do end up writing or doing, like what I went through that shift, that is exactly what causes it too, is they have some experience, something happens in life and they lose everything that they thought was important to them. And then they have that revelation of like, that wasn't everything.
All right. So now that you levitate when you meditate and you become a divine being of light.
Hey, I still drink beer. I have tattoos.
No. I understand. Now that you're on a higher plane from the rest of us.
I'm not too
airy-fairy. What do you do differently? Real fast. We've only got about half a minute. So in day-to-day life, what's different?
I don't worry. I don't worry about everything. I used to walk around constantly thinking ahead of like, what could happen? What if?
Again, good medication.
Yeah. There's nothing that I'm truly afraid of anymore, and life becomes joy, which is what it was meant to be in the first place.
God, we were so close.
It was meant to be
close, and then you had a hippie out, didn't you?
I did.
I didn't believe any of this hippy-dippy BS either. Now you do.
Right,
people want it. Where do they get it?
They can get it at the Tattered Cover, all the Tattered Cover stores, tattercover.com. The Boulder Bookstore has it.
Amazon has it.
Amazon's got it, of course. And there's an Audible on Amazon as well.
That's great stuff. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I appreciate it, Julie. Thank you. Read me in the Denver Post. Listen for me on KHOW. Check out the Independence Institute at thinkfreedom.org. See you next week.